Making this album, and the idea came from my realizing that so many musicians are put into what we call a pigeonhole. Whatever is the record that made them famous, they were continually encouraged to do that same kind of thing time and time again. I'm looking for people from various genres that I feel might be interested in exploring the territory that could possibly develop from a collaboration with me. And perhaps, maybe something totally different would happen. The record is really a collaboration between myself and a lot of different artists.
Right.
You know, and the spirit of it is that each artist brings what they bring to the table. I bring what I bring to the table, and then we see, you know, what happens when we get together. Because, like, you know, there's certain things I bring to the table from my experience, mm-hmm. you know, from coming from jazz, and then there are things that you bring to the table. Your youth, your connection to the music of the era that you're born in, you know, and it's turned out to be really nice.
Good.
You
know?
In my life and time, I've sung a lot of songs, made some bad rhymes. I've acted out my life in stages with 10,000 people watching. We're alone now, and I'm singing a song for you. What I ought to be.
Can I have more reverb, please?
I treated you unkindly. Baby, can't you see? There's no one more important to me. So, darling, can't you please see through
me? I can't hear myself. I need more reverb. I need to be higher.
Song to you. I love you in a place where there's no space or time. I love you for my life. You're a friend of mine. And when my life is over, remember we were together.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no lie.
Cute, man.
I said, I better go back to the drawing board.
You want to listen to that?
Yeah, sure, let's go in. I had to take off my sweater. I got too hot.
Yeah, right, I'm hot too. I feel that many of our systems that worked to encourage creativity are being challenged. And there's more of encouragement to stay where you are. Don't make a wave. I think the word that kind of captures the spirit of what I believe in and what I'm really about and what I hope to achieve is the word possibilities. As children, we have that sense that anything is possible, and we have that kind of openness. We're not jaded. The older we get, the more closed-in we get, the more frightened we get, the more set in our ways we get, because we're afraid of the unknown. Whereas, as a child, everything is unknown. What a beautiful place to reside in, you know, in your own being, you know, where you still have the wonder of a child.
That's cool for the middle of the tune.
But when Herbie starts to play, we going in.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, you know. What can I do for Herbie? And then the only thing I can imagine is that, okay, he must want me to play in my own little way. So I didn't really get that nervous coming in because I knew that I must have been asked for something I've already done, which is definitely not playing jazz because I just butcher it. So I'm just kind of trying to do my thing, whatever that might be, and see what that turns out to.
On that bridge part, what did you say, that popish thing? Yeah. I wonder if we could... And on that D chord, if we can make it like a B flat chord with the D on the bottom.
Okay.
You know, like that B flat 2. I call it 2. And then the G chord, put a B on the bottom.
I didn't know what to expect. I'd never met John Mayer before. I had been told that John had an idea. And I didn't know what the idea was.
I had written this groove on the guitar at home the day before. So I started playing this groove.
We just started to just get a groove going, and then little by little some melodic fragments formed.
To this day, I don't know exactly what he had before we started playing. But somehow, right away, things started to happen. Thank you.
more like just vocal, and that's very nice.
But now, you did that after you said. I enjoy the process of collaborative effort. Influence each other and share ideas, pick off energy from the vibe of each other.
Check it out. Give me that break again. Girls like that don't sleep alone. Write that down. Girls like that don't sleep alone. Yeah.
When the moment is right, you just have to really channel what that song is all about and stay there for as long as possible in that pinhole of focus and just write as fast as you can. Because, you know, you get out of that and it's gone.
Exactly how you see it is exactly how it all went down.
Yeah, I wish I could bend the note.
Chordal structure started to be built, rhythmic structure, rhythmic ideas. And then he was making up a melody. He probably had some melody ideas before, but he didn't have lyrics. So he just started making up some words as he went along. And some of them were really good.
Don't move a thing now. The kind I know I'ma never go. The girls like that don't sleep alone, say.
A friend of mine, Pino Palladino, great bass player also. Pino and I had lunch one day, and Pino says, yeah, man, the last thing you need is a girl to stitch you up. And I went, what does that mean? You know, stitch you up, like, you know, do you wrong. And I went, wow, that's cool. Stitch me up.
Stitched up, out of my mind, feeling strung out, lagging behind, all trapped in. Can't do a thing because I'm locked down. Stitched up, feeling the burn, all strung out. I finally learned that, trapped in. You can't do a thing because you're locked down. Strung out, trap me in and lock me down. Oh, stitch me up and string me out. Trap me in and lock me down, stitch me up, string me out, lock me down.
He's out for a second. He'll be right back.
All right. So when he comes back, let's have him and all everybody meet.
Here he is. Now. He's back. Hold on.
So we all know who's here.
I am. Yeah.
Here I am.
Greg.
Hi.
Ah. So here's Raul.
Hey, Greg.
Hey, Raul. How are you, man?
Good.
Excellent.
Hey, Raul.
Hey.
Hey. Sounds beautiful, man.
Well, thank you. In terms of like the phrasing, is there room for, well, I'll just sing. I mean, is there room for like going a little bit over? Is it exactly what the synth, or is that just
try things?
Excellent.
We're doing a truly bicoastal session. Yeah. Herbie and Greg are in LA, and we're here in New York, and we're working together bicoastally in real time. It's pretty amazing.
You know, Herbie doesn't have to solo in it.
you just really kicked Herbie out of his own solo. I hope you feel good about that. I don't know.
I mean, you know, forget his name's on the record, but he didn't really have to solo there. We were just, that's just in case nothing else came up.
Don't worry about it. I'll get all the credit for it. It's okay.
No New Year's Day to celebrate. No chocolate covered candy hearts to give away. No first of spring.
Okay, do not be sorry. Okay?
Yeah.
Bingo. Bingo on the first verse.
Yeah.
Bingo on the first verse.
Yeah.
Let me get that entrance again, too, anyway. Just the Noe Bro.
The first phrase was cool.
Yeah, sweet. Yeah. Wow. You forgot the lyrics, so sweet.
Does he have an embrace?
He
passed.
Just the Noe Bro.
No New Year's Day.
I like that.
To celebrate.
And this is an incredibly reworked version of this song. I was so glad when I heard the track because it's a different thing, so that it doesn't sound like the great, you know, Stevie Wonder track that it was. It sounds like something completely different.
I just called to say I love.
Herbie is a major force in terms of my inspiration as a musician, as an artist. Just, you know, just the amazing arc of the career. It's inspiring, you know, for me, and I'm sure for all of us who are doing this, you know, that somebody didn't rest on the incredible laurels that he had just from being with Miles.
On piano, Herbie Hancock.
I joined his band when I was 23, and I left when I was 28. The majority of my 20s was spent playing with Miles Davis' band.
And here comes Miles Davis.
There were certain things that he said and certain things that he stood for that have had a profound influence on my music. and on my life. There were so many things I learned from Miles about standing up for what you believe in. And I learned a lot about listening from Miles. About turning whatever happens musically into something of value. That's what you try to do, rather than be judgmental about what some other guy is playing. Leave judgment out of the picture and just take what's there and make something happen with it. He told us that he paid us to practice on the stage in front of the people, not in our rooms. Yes, we can practice in our rooms, but don't bring that down and play that in front of the people, because that's not jazz. You know, jazz is at the moment. You play the moment, and it has a, you know, each moment is fresh. That's not an easy thing to do. It takes a lot of courage, it takes a lot of trust, and it takes a kind of nakedness to be able to accomplish that. At least to be able to approach it, even. But Miles provided a platform for all the members of his then young band to examine that arena, to reach beyond the comfort zone, you know, and go into areas of, where we don't know intellectually or musically what the result is, you know, kind of go into that dark room and create something.
Hello.
There's two trains.
See if there's another way in.
Well, there's one big dog.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Nice. Thanks.
Great. Thanks.
How are
thanks
you?
For inviting me to this
place. Good.
Trey told me that the inspiration for him for a long time, for many, many years, since he was a kid, was the Jack Johnson record of Miles Davis. I was on that record. You know, he said that to him was an inspiration for the whole jam band scene. You know, sometimes you get in a rut, and you it seems like everything he plays sounds the same.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a horrible feeling. But it was one of those times, and I think Miles noticed it. So he leaned over to me and he said, don't play the butter notes. And I said, okay. I had no idea what he was talking about. So I was thinking, what does that mean? Butter notes. I thought, fat notes. Harmonically, I started thinking, well, what's obvious? The third and the seventh. It tells you whether it's major or minor, whether it's diminished or major or, you know. I said, well, let me try leaving out the thirds and the sevenths as an exercise. I knew that Miles didn't care how good you sounded. You know, he wasn't about that. He only cared that you were working on something. Miles made us feel comfortable. Yeah. He would never tell us what to play. Never. Never. He would give us something to figure out so we could figure out the solution ourselves. Which is, that's how a master teaches. A master doesn't tell you what to do because a master wants you to reveal yourself. I mean, this is real collaboration that we're doing here. None of the arrangements are just finished the night before or two or three nights before, completely done, the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed, and everything is all planned, and everybody gets told what to do. None of this record so far has been done like that. It's all been really decided at the session.
What I would naturally do is I would start composing this stuff a little bit more. So that you have these jam band sections, but you take some of those things.
Right.
And that would be my natural inclination. If there's anything I could add,
then
I would start thinking, you know, of trying to make it a little more structured. Whereas the Headhunters or even the Miles thing, I mean, Miles did it with that, with like Bitches Brew, with the theme.
Oh, yeah. What you just described, I can do that.
Okay.
That's not why I'm here.
Okay, great.
You know what I mean?
All right, that's good.
I'm here because of stuff that I don't know what to do. I was trying to get more of what he's been doing the territory that he's been exploring lately. I was trying to pull that out of him, but he wasn't going that way. If I wanted to hit it, I could call Paul Jackson and do that, get the hit on it.
Let's say you took, and tell me if this is, I'm just talking.
Go ahead.
So let's say you took.
No, look, I'm open to all ideas.
Let's say you took this idea here.
Mm-hmm.
You take an hitter on whatever, you know.
Yeah,
but then,
it does have that flavor.
That's
nice.
Very nice.
That's
nice.
And so let's say
was that the last thing?
That was the last thing.
Yeah, that was pretty much.
And then where's that thing that... Even if they were just signposts.
Right.
And we do that like, you know, 48 times and then...
We really wanted to get crazy what you could do.
Everybody kept getting more and more ideas about, oh, why don't we try this? And put this track on and try this track. How about if we put this on top? Pretty soon, we buried the track. You know, you can't even hear what we originally had.
Then it's not at all. That's pretty much what they're all dancing to out there.
That's what we're talking about, right?
Look at the world. So much stuff that you're excited about. Yeah. It's really infectious, you know, and it makes me think that anything's possible, because I think that there's people I know that, you know, they just stop.
As soon as they latch on to something where people will say, hey, that's really good, then they want to stay there because there's security, there's acceptance, there's whatever there is, you know, and they feel comfortable. And they don't want to move outside that comfort zone. But the hip stuff is outside the comfort zone.
Right.
Discovery process of who you are as an individual. At the end of the day, nobody can take from you what's created by your own being. Yeah, this is one of those kind of songs that a lot of ways it could go. It's actually it's C sharp minor 7 flat 5 is what it is, with F sharp on the bottom.
Oh,
that help?
You know that I love you. You know that I love you. You know that I love you.
I'm trying to figure out, should I go into falsetto there or just...
Oh, no. Full voice, I think.
You know that I love you.
Yeah, it's more feel.
And that love endures.
Okay. Now, I wrote my part out.
So hush now. Don't explain. There ain't nothing to gain. Well, I'm glad you're back, but don't explain.
They suggested the song Don't Explain. And I said, wow, that's cool. It's a Billie Holiday tune. Can they deliver that? You know, these are two very young artists from Ireland.
Skip that.
And then it goes, mm-hmm. When it comes back, would it be better to go into, straight into the, you know that I love you, and what love endures, all my thoughts are of you, I am so completely yours. Don't wanna hear folks chatter, cause I know you're cheap. Right or wrong don't matter, when I'm with you, sweet.
When I hear a blues singer sing, I mean, that's sensitive, heartfelt stuff. Damien and Lisa sound like that. She just tears your heart out.
Hush now, don't explain. You know, you're my joy and you're my pain.
But there's so much jazz in the notes and phrases that she picks. I mean, she was singing the ninths and the elevenths of the chords. I mean, some of the things sound like choices that Miles would have made.
Don't explain.
I like that sound. Yeah. Whatever that was.
Huh? What?
Whatever that thing was.
Oh, what I just did?
Yeah.
I don't remember. Are we there yet? Are we getting there?
We're getting there. Yeah. It's like a party, man.
It's very, very special. It's a whole, it's, this is what I dream all of my life to be around. And it ain't about the color. I feel the same way about Bob Dylan.
Music doesn't just grow out of thin air. It comes from the lives of the people that are playing it, the human spirit of the artist, and not just from the notes and harmonies and from their musicality.
I'm waiting for you.
My love, my darling.
Yeah. Oh, I see. Yeah. Which African language is
Safi, Safi
is this?
This one is Bambara.
Bambara.
From Mali.
From Mali?
Bambara,
oh.
Yeah.
Bambara, okay. How many languages do you speak?
8. Whew. I write in Mina. Mina, Mina, Mina.
What are you saying?
No. Say, come, let's all get together.
Okay.
And be stronger together.
Okay.
Things that I want to do with this record is have the music grow out of the realities of life. We've taken some time to kind of get to know each other just personally, talk about other kinds of things, politics.
I think free thought in this country is at a loss now.
Well, there's no thought.
You're labeled unpatriotic.
Well, exactly.
To question.
If you are working toward touching the parts of a person's life that have to do with elegance,
beauty, dignity, elegance, grace. Excellence, grace, dignity.
Exactly. It's the opposite of those who are trying to touch the part of a person's being that is about power for the sake of power.
This is the thing, man. We don't have to worry about anybody else is doing. All you need to do is that every day is a battlefield. But if you fight with anger, you're the problem. Right. If you fight with joy, you're the solution.
Shows you how cynical we human beings we try to be and how mean we can be by trying to call ourselves gods, because next to every embassy you find huge holes with dead bodies in it because of the genocide. Millions of them have been killed. Millions. It's hard for me to find joy every day because everywhere, every step you go, you find on your way barriers that just hold you back. It's like pounding on the wall that doesn't want to move. But I will pound on the door till the door falls, because it has to be like that.
But light is stronger than darkness.
Oh.
And you have a lot of light in you. You know, conviction is from your soul.
Oh,
you know?
Definitely.
You have to have conviction to go out there and say, you can't stop me. You cannot break my spirit. Before I go, and I'm done with this body, there will be some hearts that will be touched by my spirit. Divine treat, Mr. Herbie Hancock, Mr. Wayne Shorter.
Of all the living musicians today, Wayne Shorter is the one at the top of my list that grabs my attention and my respect and my admiration. met Wayne back in the early 60s before I joined Miles' band. I remember thinking, Wayne is brilliant, but I can't tell whether it's that he's a genius or he's a madman. Well, I find out he's a genius.
You know, come out there vulnerable and walk the walk, thoughts, words, and deeds.
We were married on a rainy day. The sky was yellow and the grass was gray. We signed the papers and we drove away. I do it for you.
It's a duet, so the vocals only half of what's going on, and the other half is hurting. Well, of course, that's much more exotic. This feels a little.
Paul mentioned maybe we could do it as a duet. I said to Paul, what if we had maybe two or three percussionists create some kind of exotic rhythm track? Percussion certainly could allow the spirit of a duet and not interfere with it.
What are you guys thinking rhythmically?
Paul Simon came to the recording studio a day earlier than he was scheduled. Actually, I got to the studio. He was already there, helping to organize the percussion section. Did do Graceland, combining a rhythmic track that had kind of North African, Middle Eastern influence. It kind of triggered those memories in his head, you know.
Even though Herbie says, look, I don't want to make a jazz record, you know, I think what he means is he doesn't want to make a cliched jazz record.
Sky was yellow.
Oh. The big surprise was that he said to me, hey Herbie, you think there's a way for you to do my tune in a minor key? And I went, yeah, I think so. Not only did Paul ask me if I could do his song in a minor key, but the other suggestion he made was to do the song and just have one minor chord. And I thought about it, and I said, well, there's a way to approach that.
Deal.
No, 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 that's okay, that's okay.
If I were trying to do a record just for the fans that already buy my records, then I could just do the regular jazz record. But I'm looking to show other sides of me influenced by other people, by the environment, by the times. Science and technology for a number of years. When I was a kid, when I was like 5 years old, even before I started playing piano, I used to take apart watches and put them back together, and I tried to take apart my electric lino, electric terrine, you know, and put it back together. Most of the time, they didn't work when I put them back together, but I was always this curious kind of kid, you know. I was an engineering major in college for my first 2 years.
You got minus two, minus one, two, all right.
1, 2. Synthesizers didn't come on the scene until around the 70s, very late 60s. I was there, yeah. This is amazing. This is not just a piano. It is a synthesizer. This instrument, this keyboard, which works with this computer here and this monitor here, all these things work together. And you can have so many other different kinds of things that you can't do on a piano. For example, I can play... See? Flutes. I want you to make laughter. How about that?
Okay.
Play this note.
Say it!
Herbie's exuberance about technology and his sense of adventurism, just new ways to create, you know, and you know, going into new possibilities is definitely contagious.
I was becoming more and more frustrated with the music that I was playing. All of a sudden, I started thinking about Sly Stone. Well, I was into Sly Stone, you know. And I started thinking, boy, thank you for letting me be myself again. That's the funkiest thing I ever heard in my life, you know. Would I like to play something that's funky? The answer was yes.
That's just funky, dude. Yes.
Imagine if you had this during Headhunters.
Oh!
The idea of fusion was not a new concept, but usually fusion was rock and jazz, but I'm thinking about funk. We started writing these tunes and did this record that we call Headhunters. I was coming really from my Imwandishi side, from the stuff I did back in the early 70s, the avant-garde area that I worked in. 80s. I was at the right place, at the right time, with the right people. I heard scratching as kind of an ambient kind of sound, you know, but in a rhythmic fashion. I said, yeah, I want to do something with that.
Rocket was a great turning point. The origins of hip-hop start really in the late 70s. Herbie was certainly one of the first, if not the first, jazz artist to implement those elements.
I had no idea that anything would happen with it. I remember one time somebody told me that they went to a breakdance contest. There were 25 groups, and they could each choose any piece of music they wanted to break to. 24 of them chose Rocket. I said, I'm glad I wasn't there. I don't think I would have wanted to hear that thing 24 times.
Been changes in my music. I would say that my music has gotten broader. And for me, it's like expanding the colors that I can choose from for expression. Something to Annie. So I asked Paula Cole if she had some things that maybe I could show to Annie. And she told me that Annie was like probably the major influence on her musically and as a singer. Anyway, I sent some things to Annie, and one piece in particular she really loved, which was called Hush, Hush, Hush.
Because I go like this, Herbie, I go, hush, 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 and then we get your chord change. Hush, hush, hush.
Right. Yeah.
You mean his father wanted a girl?
That's why this line, look to your father for some support. Because that's right. The one I never quite understood.
Peace, peace, peace. May you go in peace. Hey, Herbie.
Yeah, I'm here.
You know, I just had an idea just to do... maybe next time. Wake up tomorrow. But it can be in the background, you know, it doesn't have to be too strong.
I love it, I love it.
Okay. The male personas that wherever, you know, you'll come
right.
back as
right.
men, manly men.
Right. Right.
You know, Henry VIII, pretty manly man, apparently.
Right.
Alexander the Great, right, maybe right. you... That's a funny little twist. Hush, hush, hush. hush, hush, hush.
I think the daughter is realizing the father has this profound disappointment in his life, which he is in basic denial, because he's going hush. You know, it's like, I'm the dad. Hush, take, you know, don't worry.
That's how I say. That makes the most sense.
Herbie, listen, as the leader, as our leader,
right?
Put that call in.
I actually have Herbie here, and he wants to ask you a question if it's not a bad time for you. Okay, hold on.
Yay. Hold on. All right, how are you? Great. We've been doing hush, hush, hush with Annie. Everybody's been speculating as to what, you know, the true meaning of the song is. So that have been, how many interpretations?
Six,
seven, or eight different interpretations. And we want to know for sure, right?
Yeah, he is Annie. Yes, Paul.
Hi, Paul. That phone call was like a lightning bolt in my life. I'll always remember that phone call. I love them both so much. And when I spoke to Annie on the phone, she said, yeah, I guess you tried to meet me at one of my shows in Australia. And I said, Annie, you don't understand. I've been to every show of yours, you know, starting from 1983, the Sweet Dreams tour.
Oh, it's such a wonderful song. I love this song. It's very haunting. We've all been so intrigued by it because we were, especially me, desperate to know exactly what the story is behind it. We're just trying to piece it together. That's why I was saying all along, Herbie, you've got to call her and find out really what this is about.
Lyrically, it's complicated, but chordally, it's different. It's not the normal. And especially at the end, it goes into this cycle of major seven chords that almost feels like, I mean, the song, as it's revealed, is about a young man dying of AIDS.
It's about a young man dying of AIDS. That's what it is.
We never got that.
Oh, God.
And her...
Oh, it's about somebody that you already knew.
I have wanted to write about that because a friend of mine died from AIDS. But it's such a heavy, big subject, and how do you sing about such a thing without it becoming morose or banal? Or I had to do it in a way that was tender.
His relationship with his father was never right. You know, finally, as he's dying, they're stumbling through trying to finally it's coming out, you know.
Actually, now we know what it is. It's, it does give it a hell of an anchor, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Hell of a context,
yeah. All your life, you kept it hidden inside. Now when you step, you stumble, you die.
This is a record without borders. It'll be like a tapestry that's woven with many, many colors.
Under the waves before love rescued me.
was a fighter, I could turn on a thread. Now I stand accused of the things I said. When love comes to town, I'm gonna jump that train. When love comes to town, I'm gonna catch that flame. Maybe I was wrong to ever let you down, but I did what I did before love.
And I don't know. I don't know if this will work or not. But when we do the vocal thing, what if it would, what if the kick drum is like a or like a?
It would.
Yeah, it can have.
So like a hip hop thing and do that.
I'd have to see how it is.
Sure.
Yeah.
Pissed his side, but I seen love conquer the
great divide.
Okay, alright.
Right on,
that's okay, great. Let me try. Oh my god, I'm gonna forget by the time I get in there.
No, you won't. No, you won't. I got you.
I threw the dice when they pissed his side, but I seen love conquer the great divide.
Yeah, awesome.
I sat in with them about 3 times. All the models would come to the theater to see Sting. Every night it was like fine chicks everywhere.
Yeah, how are you?
I'm quite
nice
with the other side.
Oh, hey, Donna, how are you?
Oh, hi. Merle?
How are you?
What?
Hi. Hey, how you doing?
John,
nice to see you.
Nice to see you, too. I'm so glad you're here.
Happy birthday.
I don't want to play this shit.
when was it?
What?
My birthday was last Saturday.
That's Saturday.
Belated happy birthday.
Thank you, everybody.
So, how old are you now?
I'm 53.
53? I figured it out.
I'm the same age as you.
Yeah, right.
When Sting suggested Sister Moon, at first I started to think, you know, maybe we should, you know, write something specifically for this, something new.
Right.
But then I started to think, well, maybe we could come up with another way to do it. So I called Lionel Lueke, who is an amazing guitar player from Benin, West Africa. He was a member of the student band for the Thelonious Monk Institute of Jazz. I called him and asked him, I said, Lionel, do you think you could come up with some kind of arrangement idea that utilizing some of the stuff from Africa, you know, with the tune Sister Moon.
So he made this arrangement, which I looked at it, but I haven't really played it. But I looked at some of the chords and stuff. It's kind of cool.
Cool. Because of the particular culture that it comes from in Benin, West Africa, there are some elements that he can lend to the music that give it another kind of twist. I didn't know what Lionel was going to come up with.
It's not a...
Oh, sorry.
It's a lot about the rhythm. It's a lot about the spirit, too, you know, the way you... The same phrase can be played from like 10 musicians, and they all will play differently. Like if they're musicians from Africa, from America, from Europe, they're all gonna play different because from where you grow up, you have that background inside you naturally.
It overlaps stuff we know, but it's got this other stuff.
He cements it together with his vamp. What is vamp?
Something that took us, quote, pros, a while to really kind of grasp the heart of it. You know, it wasn't, yes, we could play it, but to really, like, own it, it took a while.
I keep screwing it up myself.
You gotta pay attention to this. Yeah, I gotta.
Yeah.
I tried to do the really thing. I couldn't really get it. Well, you saw how long it took us to get to find the meat of it?
Oh, yeah.
Every night, you don't care what I do. I go out of my mind. I go out of my mind.
One of my dreams was to be in America, and one of my highest dreams was to play with the best, you know, Herbie, Wayne, and you know, it's like, for me, I'm living my dream, definitely.
He's really talented. I want him to get everything he deserves. Because he's a sweetheart of a guy. That's the kind of people we want to be big stars. Mm. I'm sick of the assholes.
I didn't know he was that bad. I didn't know he was that happening. I mean, I knew you could sing, you know, but, you know, but he was doing a lot of stuff I'd never heard of.
You were killing me. I never heard you sing like that.
Me neither.
I mean, you. It really took my practice of Buddhism to help me to realize that those lessons that were taught to me about music, these lessons are really apply to life. I mean, isn't it a human being's highest goal to be able to take whatever happens, whether it's feast or famine, whether it's pleasant things or unpleasant things, to take those things and somehow turn them into something of value. Opinion that I am a musician. I used to think that. I don't think that anymore. Because I realize, because of this practice, that I am a human being first. Being a musician is something that I do. It's not something that I am. I'm much more interested in improving my life, and my life as a servant of humanity. I realize also that that's the purpose of my music, is to serve humanity.
What is your purpose for coming to Hiroshima?
We're hoping to throw as large a stone as we possibly can into the ocean of ideas to draw attention to the importance of the establishment of a lasting peace. In particular, jazz performers have been cultural ambassadors. I mean, you know, Duke Ellington and Dizzy Gillespie have played all over the planet and have written pieces inspired by the different cultures that they've been exposed to. Members of the country that did this horrible, tragic act. It was our way to represent the American spirit of sorrow and apology. Necessary to constantly be reminded of the kind of results that are a product of man's inhumanity toward man.
This is the actual bomb, the replica of the actual bomb. Mm. It's called the Fatima bomb.
When it's too late, we find out about the beauty of something that we destroy.
We must ensure that the lives who were lost, their suffering, was not in vain for the future and survival of those who inhabit the earth. I've been able to realize that there isn't just one way of looking at things, or there isn't just one way to look at
the difficulties we have in life. There's an infinite number of ways to look at things. Sometimes we have to create that vision or that possibility, but the human spirit has the ability to be able to do that. He said choose Harvard. First I thought,
she's
okay,
crazy.
It was something, she's screwing around with. But you said, no, I can really put it choose Harvard. And something told me, I wonder if she's telling the truth, you know?